So hello everyone, this is a Q&A session. So let's see you raising your hands and like asking questions. Go ahead. Anything that is not clear or problems you are facing with whatever you're doing.
Hello. Sorry, I joined the stand-up late. So I think this question being asked, the real task is to fine-tune the model, not training. Am I right?
Yes. You are supposed to fine-tune. Pre-training is something that takes a lot of resources. So you're not supposed to be doing that.
Okay. So we can take any model, even if it have a low performance in Amharic, and fine tune it. Am I right?
In principle, yes. Natnael, can you take this one?
Okay. So for this one, I think it's better to use a model that actually understands Amharic. We just want you guys to know how each process is done. So, for example, you started from collecting the data, right? And now the next step is to just use the data and fine tune your model. So, if it's just let's say you collected some political news, and now you want your LLM or the fine-tuned model has to understand more of that. It's just like, so you won't pre-train it, but you just fine-tune it. But you have to again use somehow a model that understands Amharic. So, you can just fine tune a model that doesn't understand Amharic. That's why we actually put more of the resources, especially for Amharic one, on the Gari Logistics pre-trained model.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, Wandra. Go ahead.
I wanted to try to understand fine-tuning exactly. So fine-tuning is basically we're going to train models that are already available using the data we collected. That's what fine-tuning is. We're going to use existing models to train them using the specific data we collected last week. Is that what fine tuning is?
Yes.
Okay.
And for Abu Bakr's question, I think for the annotation part, it would have been better if you did the annotation last week, because now if you have time, you should do it. But if you don't have time, try to focus more on the fine tuning and also understanding the data collected. But that doesn't mean it's not important. So maybe try to divide tasks, so few of the members should do the annotation, and the others should do the fine tuning and collecting part.
So just to clarify on this, maybe like I can ask a couple of questions right now. So for fine tuning, the thing that they can do is that they can, there is already some available data that is already labeled, and they can basically use those. Is that like if they don't want to, or if, like if they are not going to be successful, or like they are not going to be able to annotate as much data as needed, maybe they can supplement by using like already available data. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, they should explore on that part too. So for example, if they find labeled data for the language of their choosing, so for example, even for Amharic, if they can find, or if they find labeled data, fine tuning with the labeled data is much better than fine tuning with some random data. So actually, the model will be fine tuned exactly how it is intended to.
Yeah, so you're supposed to be using, so what Nathan has said is that you're supposed to be using labeled data for fine tuning. And you either get this labeled data from your own work on annotation, so the data you collected and annotated yourself, but you can also find, and you should explore that, you can look for the data that is already prepared and labeled, like just look like on Hugging Face, for example, we can look for data sets there. But yeah, so basically this is how it, like you need the data to find too, so you cannot do this part without the other one. Okay, so other questions? DJ?
Hello, good morning everyone.
Good morning. Yeah,
so my question is on this. We are in this week, we are actually just fine tuned Llama 3D, right? The aim is just fine tuned Llama 3 or whatever. But I said, so the data set we collected last week is not, I think, not good for this purpose, right? Just we, for example, for our group, we just scrapped some news. On BBT, on other things, and so actually it is not meet for this purpose. Just for example, I search on some data sets on Hugging Face or Kaggle for maybe for the purpose of like translation or summarization. So there is a data set that relates to that. So based on that, we can fine tune Llama 3, right? So for example, maybe we need to just prepare other data set, for example, for the purpose of summarization. So in one column, so there is a bunch of text on the first, so and on the second column, there is a summarization. So based on our data set, we can just feed to the model, and after that, maybe we fine tune, then we can test based on our data set, right? So that is what we are going to do right on this week.
Okay, so you're trying to find the data set again. So you collected the data set last week, but you didn't do the annotation, so now you have some unlabeled and also unstructured data. So now if you find, given you have like a very short amount of time, choosing that path would be much more feasible for now, because labeling it with it might take time. So try that approach too. Just try to explore now that you will know how to do it and what approach you should take at the end of the week if the same challenges are given to you. So for example, as mentioned yesterday, now you know where to look for a data. You might not look again for a news data set from BBC. You might not look again to collect data from Facebook or Telegram. Now you'll know where to find your data sets. That's the main objective of the last week's challenge, so that you will know which data are located where and for what purpose you can use those data sets. So for example, for the news part, you can just maybe try to use entity recognition systems. Maybe you can annotate that one, and at the end you will try to come up with some entity recognition or named entity recognition from some images or from some text. But I think most of the groups haven't actually reached the annotation part. So now you just do another approach and find labeled data. That doesn't mean like discard all the data you have collected. Make sure to actually collect as much again. And also a channel will be created where you guys should share all the data you collected. So every group can use as much data as they can. And also, as mentioned yesterday, we need to collect as many tokens as possible. So for example, even 100,000 rows of data, Telegram data is not enough. And also 500,000 rows of news data is not enough. But if we actually unite all the groups, we might actually get enough, not enough, but somehow a little bit more tokens. Is that clear, Director?
Yes. Yeah, it's clear now.
Okay, so there was a question about tokenization, but like Bassa Hamid asking, can you elaborate more on the tokenization part? But like, I asked, like, can you be more specific about this question? Like, what exactly don't you get about tokenization, or what exactly are you want to be explained? So tell Bassa Hamid, like, answers this. Is there anyone who like have another question? Like, you really, I mean, you're either get everything by now, that's why you are not asking any questions, or okay, Daisy.
So I asked in the morning if there's another group using Swahili data. Can anyone like mention if they're using Swahili?
No one else is using Swahili. It was only one group that was using Swahili. That's you are at a disadvantage on that sense.
So what would you recommend for us? Because clearly we need like a lot of data. What would be the best way forward?
Okay, so let's think. So okay, of course we are going to take into account that you are the only group that is doing Swahili, but let's start by the first thing. Like, the first thing that you need to do, or like this is like was emphasized by Yababol yesterday. So you need to get like some kind of like whatever data you collected or you're going to collect by the end of the week. You should know how much you have, and you should have some kind of a sense or an estimation of how much data is still out there that you can get that can be used. So this is the first thing you have to know, because like thinking about this, not only a challenge for this week, but also like something that, think about it as a project that you actually want to do. Let's say you're going to be paid for, and you want to see how feasible it is that you can actually fine tune a model to really work well with Swahili. So you have to know how much data is out there that maybe you can use when you do this project for a longer time. So this is the first part. The second part is that for the actual fine tuning of this week that you want to do, you will need some labeled data in Swahili. You also need a model that already maybe understands Swahili, that I think there was one provided in the document, the challenge document, if I'm not wrong. So for the labeled data, you have to do your own labeling, okay? But you should also search for labeled data out there. Maybe they are already available. So this is part of your data search. You're searching for raw data, just text that is available on the internet, but you also should look for data sets that are already prepared. So maybe you can start from Hugging Face and maybe also look generally on the web, on the internet for any data that is already labeled and ready to be used. And you should also do your own labeling. So for how to manage your time, you're a team of how many people? Are you four or five?
Five.
You're five people. So maybe you should assign one person to each one, like someone who should be looking for the data, someone should be looking for the data that is like raw, someone should be maybe like one or two should be like setting up the annotation and working on it, and the rest of the team should be like actually working on like understanding how to do the fine tuning and working with whatever data that is ready already, they can use it to fine tune. So like try to manage your time that way. You are not going to be able to do everything, but just be prepared that by the end of the week should have a sense. Not just a guess, but actually based on what you experience throughout the week, you should have an answer to the question, how many data is out there? When you fine tune the model with whatever data you have already, how better performance did you get? You should have some kind of work on labeling and see like a future plan of how to do this and improve it for the future. Does that make sense to you? Like, Daisy? Are you still there?
Yes, fine, thank you.
Okay, great. Next question. So Gitasho, go ahead.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, thank you. When we are trying to use pre-trained models, what is the best way to use them? Are we going to download it to our machines, or are we going to import it to Hugging Face? Which one is the best way to do with them?
Okay. For the fine-tuning part, try to make sure to use the instances, because they are a lot more capacity than any local machines you have. But if you believe you have enough GPUs that can handle the fine-tuning part, you can use a few, but just make sure you have enough capacity.
No, this was not my concern. I was trying to say that we can use the pre-trained models that can be imported through Hugging Face, or just download it to our machines. to the servers.
Try to import it using Hugging Face. Just so, for example, if you are applying while you're fine tuning, if you are applying LoRa or pure LoRa, and also mostly you have to use parameter efficient fine tuning. So it's just better to import it using Hugging Face, and the next process would be choosing the parameters you want, or to fine tune the weights, the specific weights. You won't be able to actually fine tune the whole weight. So for example, if you are using Llama 3 8 billion, you won't be able to fine tune the whole weights, which means the whole 8 billion. So you'll just use the only few of them. So for example, you might only use maximum at 1 million. So just to import it using Hugging Face. And also you'll find most of the resources are somehow related. Other steps are related to that, which means you are just importing it using Hugging Face. Is that clear?
Yeah, it's clear.
And for Bethlehem's question, so just tokenization is actually representing the text. So for example, you have hello world or hi or good morning. So you actually represent each word, or for example, you can use each word. So for example, good and morning will have their own identification. Or their own, let's just say they will be represented in some space, for example, using a number. So now let's say you are tokenizing a book. So the word good might appear hundreds of times. 100 tokens will not be created for good. So that's where normalization comes in. So for example, in Amharic, you know we have two ways of writing even the word temertabit, which is in English school. We have two ways. So when you normalize, you also consider that. And some words that have the same meaning but written in two different ways should be represented in the same way. So for example, let's say in the Chinese document, you have seen how to actually replace and normalize Amharic. And in the previous week, you shared the resource on how to replace or how to normalize an Amharic text. So you can have an efficient tokenizer or somehow an effective tokenizer. So for example, you will understand, the tokenizer will understand you the whole word set in an effective way if you normalize it correctly. So the next one would be to use subword tokenizing, which means like mostly if we take most sub-Saharan language or some most of the Cushitic language, they have rich morphology, so which means that most of them are actually translated into verbs, so which means Amharic is rich in morphology, so you can't use the same tokenizer as an English one. You have to actually understand how Amharic works and how morphology for Amharic works. And yeah, and that's when you should use, as mentioned yesterday, language-independent tokenizers. You should use that. So for example, for Amharic, it's easier because you already have Gary's tokenizer. They already pre-trained the Llama 3 for us. So now we have an easier task on our hand. Is that clear, Vitaly? Yeah, it's just if you are using, it depends on your encoding. Yeah, you just use sentence piece. So sentence piece tokenizer supports different language, so it can even represent a space. So now you can actually represent each words, and after you train sentence piece, on based on your data, you will find it will be effective in actually if you mask some word and ask it, it will replace it correctly because it actually understands how each word was tokenized and what was the distance between each of them. Bethlehem is a clear word. Okay, go on.
Okay, in the labeling part, is there any criteria or, for example, there is news or sport or so, do we add another column and say it is this news, this is news, this is sports, this is business, or is it, so we, thus we can have as many criteria as we have to label it. So is there any criteria or what is our parameter to label it? Because it is many data as well.
Yeah, so the parameter would be, it would depend on how many data you collect. So for example, let's say you collect mostly news and sport. So until you start fine tuning and until your whole data pre-processing pipeline is ready to go, you just keep collecting the data. And after that, you'll just label it depending on how you collect the data, which means, let's say you focused on news data, so you can just easily label those as a news and also as a sport, as a business easily. So it just depends on the data you actually collect. After that, you might fine tune your model to just categorize a specific news. You just can't fine tune it like that. Is that clear, Mikael?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, any other question? You can just type in the chat or raise your hand. Okay, you're now.
So for the when we are fine tuning, I'm just speculating now, but is the GPU how much computational power is needed, or is it available on the AWS? So one of us have to do the computation, the fine tuning, right?
Yeah, so it will be the GPUs will be added now. It's just on the same. You are just on the same machine without a GPU till now. But since it is expensive, it will be available when it's actually needed. So for now, just focus on the pre-processing part and on the collection part. And end of day today, it will be available. The GPUs will be available, so you'll have much more time to fine tune and train your model.
Okay, thank you.
And again, for my Mahbuba question, you will follow a structure. So for it depends on your goal. So let's say if your goal is just to summarization, it will have the text and the summarized version. And if you have to categorize, it's just will have the text and the category. Or it depends on how you collected your data and what you want to do at the end. it might have more columns, but it might have less too. Okay, let's go.
Yeah, you recommend, like when we are pre-processing, we have this, we have the old data that is not clean. When you do that, can we, would you recommend creating a new collection, like to store that one, or just add the column with the new content that is clean?
It is better to have a separate data for the cleaned one, because you might have to actually retry many times to actually fine-tune and to add something to your data. So it's better to have them separated and loosely coupled.
Yeah, so like having a separate table.
Yeah, it's better to have a separate table for the cleaned version. And also it depends. So let's say, for example, now you labeled it in a different way. And also now you want to test it by labeling it in another way. So now you will have a more flexible approach. Okay, go on, Mike.
Okay, so we are training the model for the general purpose, right? Because our data are vast and different. So at the end, how can we compare it? Like first we ask it before it's trained, and after that, can we ask the same questions and compare the results, or if there are any other criteria or parameter to compare the models before trained and after trained?
Okay, I will add some part for that one. I think it was missed in the document. So I will add how you can evaluate your model, but also just try to avoid overfitting. Basically, most of the challenges, just the model will just overfit. Right. It will actually do good in the data sets you have shown it, but if it's just a few different ones, it will hallucinate and it will not be actually as effective as it should be. And also, mostly it might be, so for example, as I've mentioned earlier, just try to make it try to fine tune it in a way it is specific for your group's case. So for example, if your group is more collecting for news data, it's just better to actually approach it in that way. You can't fine tune it in a news data and ask it to generate an essay, to generate something so unrelated, because you think you have a vast amount of data, but even combined all the groups data is way less to actually be to create an effective general purpose model. Go on, Hilar.
So my first is, so when you're pre-processing, I can see that in Amharic mostly you're changing the letters, and let's say if there's some English words in there, can we remove them, or will that be relevant for the LLM? And the second one is how is the data pipeline useful in this week? Like let's say you are scraping your data, you're running scraping, and then automatically it's going to be pre-processed. Is that pipeline useful for like when you are training the model, when you are fine tuning? Do you also include the process in the pipeline? or do we just fetch one or one whole data, like just fetch the entire data and pass it the model at once?
I think it's the second approach would be the best one. So for example, you have the data that is, you have some amount of data, and even if you double it, let's say you have 100,000 rows, and you trained your model, and as you mentioned, if your pipeline is constructed in a way that when a new data comes, it will just automatically pre-processed and get into the fine-tuning part. That will just take a huge amount of resources. So it's better to actually just separate the fine-tuning and the pre-processing or the data engineering pipeline from the machine learning or the fine-tuning pipeline. Let's just keep them separate, because it will just take a huge amount of time and resources. So for example, let's say, as I've mentioned, even collecting the 100 rows of data might take some time, and even pre-processing that will take some time, and also just fine-tuning it 100,000 might not be enough. So now you just add another 50,000. So the process will be much more difficult and challenging for you guys. So it's just better to keep them separate and loosely coupled.
Okay, thank you. And for the first one, I think.
Okay, and for the first one, I think, yeah, it's better to remove the English characters from the, let's say, if you guys script Telegram's data, there is a high chance you'll find English characters, especially links, and let's say join all Telegram or some text like that. So make sure to just use the Amharic text only. Remove any English text and also replace the characters. And also I will share the resource that was shared last week. I'll share it again in the resource section, how to normalize Amharic text.
Okay, so you mean you can change the is the approach like to change the data to is that a lot of work? Do we remove it or just remove it?
I think removing it is much better.
Okay.
Because translating it will not be effective, since most of the translations out there are not fully effective on my mind. Go on, Abra.
Okay, I might repeat this question, but how do I annotate the data? Like, is there any specific tips that you could share us? And the most of our data sources is from Telegram.
Okay, try to choose an easier approach, because you don't have a lot of time. Try to find an approach that is easier to train and also easier to annotate. Just try to use that kind of approach. And if it's mostly Telegram, if you focus on TikTok, it's just mostly news. If you focus on sports channels, it's just mostly sports. So try to label it in a way that it will be easier to process and fine tune later. Focus on rows in sport, because you have a short amount of time. Okay, I'll just make sure to share the resource and also. Okay, I'll just share the document and the resource on normalizing Amharic data, and I'll just add a section where you can find how to evaluate it.
Thank you.
Go on, Abis.
Oh, my question is on the different steps on fine tuning and pre-processing, not pre-training. So we are going to use a model from Hugging Face like Gary for Amharic that are already pre-trained. So we don't really actually do pre-training, yes? Just we use fine-tuning techniques just to fine-tune, but not pre-training. Like, we don't, maybe the embeddings, we don't do word embedding or positional embedding or other pre-training tasks, but all just fine-tuning.
You do all the tasks because you need to understand how what embedding works and how tokenization works.
Hello.
Jabez, have you had your question answered? Are you, like, do you get the...
I think he said we have to know about it, but we don't actually do pre-training on this week's task.
Yes, you're not going to be doing pre-training, you're doing fine-tuning, but you still need to tokenize and embed your text that you're going to be using for fine tuning. So that's why you need to know how tokenization and embedding works. So, like, because just simply because your model doesn't cannot interact with text as text. So you have to change your text into like a numerical vectors for the model to deal with. And to do that, you have to go through tokenization, which is breaking the text into smaller parts according to the vocabulary of the model. For that, you either use the tokenizer of the model that is already there, or you can define your own tokenizer and add. So there are two ways to do this, depending on which model you use. For example, if you're using Gary, for example, you can just use the tokenizer that Gary has defined. And then, of course, there is the embedding. There is the embedding part, which is just part of like you need to embed your text to input it to the model, basically. So does that make sense? You?
Yeah, but because I think it needs a lot of data, yes, for word embedding, because it needs to understand the relationship between, I think, the words. So it needs a lot of data to understand the relationship between words and also give out maybe textual representation.
I think so, there is some, okay. So I think there's some kind of misunderstanding on your part on this. The embedding is, how to say this? The embedding how the model embeds actually the words this is something like the model itself trains for. So there is an embedding layer, basically. But so it's not something that you have to provide to your model. The model itself is trained for a long time. The pre-training, the one that you're not doing, these big models are trained for a long time exactly to learn the embedding. Okay, so yeah, to learn the embedding, the model needs a lot of data. That's completely true, but you don't need to go through this with your data, because like you're doing the fine tuning, which is just an additional step. It's not the first training for the model. The model already had an embedding, already learned from its own pre-training. Okay. But so when you input your text to the model, you have to use the embedding of the model to translate your text into vectors that the model will deal with. Does that make more sense for you?
Yeah, but does it train word embedding on Amharic language? So isn't that different from English or other language?
Which model are you using? Are you planning to use?
Yeah. I'm trying to use the Gari, but I read the article that was shared for the, I think.
The Gari's blog, the one about the model? Yeah. Okay. Yes.
I tried to read it, but I know they did tokenization using the Google's spy split. I'm not sure. But I didn't see they doing maybe word embedding or positional embedding or something like that. It doesn't say find that on the article. So maybe they have done it and we don't have to do it, or maybe you have to do it to further pre-train.
Okay, let's. I don't know if I can explain this in a couple of minutes. Okay, so just how to say? So they it's true what you said. They define their own tokenizer, okay? Because they start with Llama. Llama is a big model that already understand English, but it doesn't understand Amharic. It wasn't trained on Amharic. So its tokenizer, the Llama tokenizer, the original one, it didn't do well with Amharic. So what the guys did is that they defined their own tokenizer. So they trained their own tokenizer, they defined it, and they added their vocabulary, the Amharic vocabulary. They got to the vocabulary of Llama. So they extended the vocabulary of the model, meaning that they added Amharic to the English that was already there. And what they did then to actually to get the embedding is that when they did the pre-training, they did pre-training, right? This is something that you don't do, but they did it. And in their pre-training, they retrained the embedding layer of the model. So the model learned through this pre-training how to embed the Amharic. So when you start, when you add your new words, your with new tokenizer and new vocabulary to the model will go into embed the new words or the new tokens, sorry, the new tokens. It will initialize like randomly first, and then it will learn through the training how to embed these words. So you don't see, it's not as something extra to the model, it's part of it. Do you get that?
Yeah, I think we just have to trust that they did the pre-training part already and maybe fine-tune it. I think that's what you're saying.
Yeah. So you not necessarily. The thing is that you don't need to, for when you're using Gari, you don't need to define a new tokenizer in particular. Like you can start by doing that. I think maybe Natnal, you can add to this. If like maybe like I'm not completely. Okay, let me say this. So in principle, or it is possible that you can use just the tokenizer that Gary is defined, and you don't define your own new tokenizer. Just like say, like you tried it and you think it's work well, so you don't need to do that anymore. And when you do the fine tuning, yes, fine, you can go ahead.
Okay, so for the tokenization and the embedding part, just you have to use the risk model part because it's just pre-trained on that. They have done the pre-trained part for us. And but you have to understand what embedding works and also how tokenization works. So you have to do it, but you won't apply it while you are in tuning. Or you won't use it as an input or as a tokenizer for your model while you're fine-tuning it, because you'll have an embedding mismatch. Just try to understand how embedding work, try to understand how tokenization works, but you will use the existing embeddings and tokenizers. Is that clear, Yavis?
Yes.
So, if there is, okay, so any final questions before we end the session? I think there's going to be another Q&A session at some point. Is that true, not now?
Come again?
Is there going to be another Q&A session?
We can have a Q&A session today, Tuesday, by Thursday.
By Thursday, okay.
Yeah.
All right, so I suppose we can end the session now. For now, any more questions could be asked on Slack, of course. And let's just end the session here. Thank you everyone for attending and for asking questions.